Thank you. may be seated.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I am Laura Hockett, the chair of the Scripps College Board of Trustees and graduate of the class of 1985. It is my great pleasure, my welcome to all of you this momentous occasion in the history of our institution, the inauguration of Amy Marcus-Newhall as the 11th president of Scripps College. On behalf of Scripps, I would like to thank the presidents of the Claremont Colleges and their representatives, delegates from higher education, our trustees, alumni, family, students, faculty, and staff, and friends of the college who have joined us here today. We are also joined by three distinguished former presidents of Scripps College, our good friends Nancy Bekovac, Lori Bettison-Varga, and Laura Tedens, all of whom have so dutifully served the institution. Nancy, Lori, and Laura, would you please stand and be recognized? And a warm welcome is also extended to President Marcus-Newhall's family, especially her father, Stan Marcus, who has traveled from Portland, Oregon to be with us today. Joining us as well is Amy's husband, Brian, along with their three children, Rachel, Emily, and David. In addition, we cannot forget a special thanks to the alumni, students, faculty, and staff who are the heart and spirit of this venerable college. Although we gather here at the outset of September 2023 to formally inaugurate Amy as the 11th president, she has already been diligently serving since April and has taken on the role of interim president not once, but twice before in 2015-16 and 21-22. So you are living proof that third time is the charm. Amy has been an integral part of the Scripps community for the past 31 years. The depth and familiarity between Amy and the college is one of the reasons why she is the ideal president for Scripps at this pivotal juncture. Having collaborated with Amy closely since April, and given my role as the board chair, I've had the privilege to witness her exceptional abilities firsthand. She adeptly synthesizes input from a myriad of often divergent perspectives, leading groups to consensus with remarkable finesse. This extraordinary skill is certain to guide the college successfully into the second century, just a few years from now. Amy, it is a true pleasure watching you lead the college and collaborating with you. We are very fortunate to have you at the helm. It is now my pleasure to turn the podium over to our distinguished speakers. The order of the speakers is in your program. Excuse me, beginning with reflections from Jennifer Armstrong, Interim Vice President for Academic Affairs and Dean of the Faculty.
Hi, everybody. It's nice to see you all. Thank you, Laura. In thinking about what to say about Amy on this important day, I thought I would share a short parable. This is a story not to be taken literally. Amy's daughter, Rachel, shared this story about universal responsibility, and I think you will agree that it really describes Amy to a T. Okay. It is called The Elephant and the Hummingbird. Once upon a time, an elephant was walking with weary steps down a road when suddenly he saw a tiny hummingbird in the middle of the road. The bright little bird was absolutely motionless, belly up, with her legs stretched skyward. "Is she dead?" thought the elephant as he approached the hummingbird. He gave her a light tap with his trunk in case she had some life left. "Hey, do not push me." The hummingbird opened her eyes. "I did not know if you were dead," the elephant said, relieved to see that the bird was fine. "But what are you doing here in the middle of the road? Someone could step on you." "Precisely. I am here so that everybody can see me," the hummingbird replied. "I have heard that the sky is going to fall on our heads today. And if that happens, I am here, ready to do my part to help hold it up." The elephant remained motionless for a moment, as if he hadn't heard what the little bird had said. Then abruptly, he burst into laughter. a trumpeting guffaw that only an elephant could blow through the amplifier of his trunk. "What is wrong with you, little bird?" the elephant asked when he managed to control his hilarity. "Do you really think that you will be able to hold up the sky with those little legs?" The hummingbird did not like that at all. Looking at the elephant angrily, she raised her head and she said, "I know perfectly well that I will not be able to hold up the sky by myself. That is precisely why I have placed myself in the middle of the road in the sight of everyone. Because then all the creatures can see me and imitate me to do everything in their power to hold up the sky. This is what is in my power to do." Okay, that is the end of the story. So why does the story of universal responsibility make me think about Amy and her leadership? And just, by the way, Amy is the hummingbird in the story. Now, I don't think this is a Chicken Little, Sky is Falling type of story. Amy is not an alarmist. She is not naive. She is not silly. So let's imagine that this is a serious possibility, and the sky in the story really could fall. But of course, the hummingbird alone cannot stop it. So how does this connect to Amy? To me, this story reflects Amy's responsibility towards others and our greater community. It reflects her ownership of a problem. Our community's problems become her problems. It reflects her dedication, her ability to buckle down and do what needs to be done. It reflects her habit of leading by example. She is doing this work by herself. She has not delegated this lying in the road task to her VPs. It reflects her willingness to be first, to take the lead, even when her actions may be misunderstood by those who don't have access to or understand the whole picture. It reflects her willingness to take a risk to help others or help the situation. That elephant might not have seen her. She might have been squashed. It reflects her willingness to literally sacrifice herself for us, for Scripps. As many of you know, she postponed her sabbatical and time with her family to take on this role. It reflects her far-sightedness. No one else sees the problem is coming, but Amy sees. The story reflects Amy's fearlessness. She is unafraid to take action to take on big problems that seem insurmountable. She is willing to take on a pandemic and the presidency three times. It reflects Amy's ability to talk faster than other humans. And if a hummingbird could talk, I think we can all agree she would sound like Amy. It reflects her ability to lead and make decisions while not being concerned with superficial appearances. She does not make choices for the sake of looking good. She makes hard choices because they are the best options at the time. And one of my favorites, the story reflects Amy's optimism in the face of awful challenges. And again, thinking of the pandemic, in our endless Zoom meetings during that long at-home COVID time, Amy would bring optimism into every interaction, no matter how challenging the decisions became. Now, many of you know that Amy has a tendency to sprinkle words of wisdom into normal conversations. This story reminds me of one of these Amy-isms that I have relied on for over the past 5 years, which is, doing nothing is a choice. You cannot turn your back on a problem and pretend it is not there. The sky will fall on you eventually. If you choose to do nothing, that is an active choice, even if it doesn't feel like it. I am thrilled to be here at Amy's inauguration because she is willing to do the work and nobody cares more about Scripps. She doesn't hide behind the idea that a problem is too hard to tackle. She does not take the path of doing nothing. She will be the first to lie down in the middle of the road if that's what is required to take on the issue, even if she knows that it is an impossible task all by herself. I, for one, am honored to join her. Congratulations, Amy. It is now my very great pleasure to introduce Ed Reese, the mayor of Claremont City. or the city of Claremont? Both, really, right?
Well, good afternoon. Today, I'm honored here to speak to you about the remarkable relationship between the city of Claremont and Scripps College, as well as extend our heartfelt congratulations to Scripps' new president, Amy Marcus-Newhall, on her inauguration. First and foremost, I want to emphasize the importance of the bond between this outstanding institution of higher learning and our vibrant city. Scripps College, nestled within Claremont, has been a cornerstone of our community for over 9 decades. Its lush campus, architectural elegance, and academic excellence are not just a part of the city's landscape, but they're an integral part of its spirit. The city of Claremont and Scripps College have shared an enduring partnership that has enriched both parties. The relationship is a testament to the principle that when a city and a college collaborate, they can accomplish great things together. Scripps College, through its students and faculty, has contributed significantly to the cultural and intellectual tapestry of Claremont. From lectures and art exhibitions to community service projects, Scripps has been an invaluable partner in nurturing our city's growth and development. This partnership has not only benefited our community, but has also provided countless opportunities for Scripps students to engage with the world outside of campus. Whether it's through internships, research projects, or volunteer work, Scripps students have had the privilege of being active citizens in Claremont, forging connections and giving back to the city that houses their academic pursuits. Today, we gather to celebrate not just this extraordinary partnership, but also a remarkable individual who will lead Scripps College into its next chapter of excellence. We extend our warmest congratulations to President Amy Marcus-Newhall on her inauguration. Amy brings a wealth of experience and a deep commitment to education. Her vision for Scripps College aligns perfectly with the values of this institution and the aspirations of our community. Under her leadership, we are confident that Scripps College will continue to shine as a beacon of education, scholarship, and empowerment for women. As we look to the future, we're excited about the possibilities that await this enduring collaboration between the City of Claremont and Scripps College. Together, we can continue to foster a dynamic, diverse and inclusive community where knowledge thrives, ideas flourish, and our shared partnership continues to grow stronger. In conclusion, let us celebrate this positive relationship that has defined Claremont and Scripps College, and let us welcome President Amy Marcus-Newhall with open arms as she leads this esteemed institution into a bright and promising future. Together, we can achieve greatness for the benefit of both the college and this wonderful city. Thank you and congratulations, Amy.
Good afternoon. It is my privilege and pleasure as president of Pomona and chair of the Council of Presidents of Claremont Colleges to celebrate with you the inauguration of Amy Marcus-Newhall as the 11th president of Scripps College. President Marcus-Newhall has been a vital part of college life here in Claremont for more than 3 decades. But rarely has someone come to the presidency with better preparation. Her work as a behavioral psychologist has dealt with the barriers that human beings raise to accepting each other's full humanity. Stereotypes about working mothers, intergroup relations, prejudice and hate crimes. She's deeply attuned to the importance of the teacher-student relationship, and she is a proven academic leader. President Marcus-Newhall has a deep respect of her colleagues across the colleges because we know she is completely no-nonsense and utterly true to her word. She has an excellent sense of humor, always good and a leader, including a love of classic animation. Now really, what could be president better than a president who loves Daffy Duck and Bugs Bunny? And being able to laugh at the parts of life that are ridiculous, even in the midst of challenges, being able to hold on to who you are at all times, these things make Amy wise, but they make me glad to be her colleague and her friend. She is never afraid to laugh, yet she is serious about what is vitally important to Scripps College. She strongly believes in its mission to empower women leaders and advances it at every turn. Under her leadership, this college will soar, continuing to implement its strategic plan as it approaches its centennial. Scripps is very fortunate, as we all know, to have someone who loves this college so well and is so dedicated to its success as its leader. She lives out the philosophy that we are always better together. She's always looking for pathways that unite people. And on those pathways, I've met her with her dog. She's in fact my new puppy parent mentor, and her labradoodle, Charlie, will help mentor me and mine. Stenbeck once wrote that a dog is a bond between strangers, but it's more of a bond between colleagues and friends. All of the Claremont colleges have a special place in American higher education, and while we are each distinct, we are united in our mission to prepare students just to make a difference, to succor the world, and to bring help where it is needed. Each college leader here makes a vital contribution to the strength of the whole. President Marcus-Newhall, the experience and wisdom you bring to our community is invaluable. You are a teacher, a scholar, a leader, and a friend. And we, on behalf of each member of the consortium, I wish you the very best as you are inaugurated president of Scripps College. I know you will lead it beautifully. I'm pleased to introduce to you Erin Matz, Scripps College Professor of English and Chair of the Faculty Executive Committee. Erin?
It's an honor to speak today on behalf of the Scripps faculty. It's a special privilege to do so for the investiture of Amy Marcus-Newhall. At these ceremonies, it's customary to welcome the honoree to Scripps, but that would be weird in Amy's case. She has been here much longer than I have, indeed longer than most of the Scripps faculty. She joined the college as a psychology professor in 1992, and for most of the past 13 years, she has been the dean of faculty. Her appointment this year makes her the only president in the history of Scripps College to have come up from the ranks of its own faculty. Now, this matters a lot to those of us who teach here. Not simply because, according to the axiom, college faculty are destined to quarrel with college administration, and so having one of our own in the presidency will lessen the likelihood of dispute. No, I mean that President Marcus-Newhall understands, as well as anyone, the particularities of the main business of this place, the reason we're here, which is teaching and studying. For Scripps, this means appreciating its precise situation at the junction of several axes. It's a liberal arts college, a women's college, a member of the Claremont Consortium, and an institution rooted from its origins in the humanities. Now, Amy herself is a social scientist. In committee meetings, she will often begin a dissection of faculty behavior with the words, "Well, as a psychologist, I." But I can say that she has always kept faith with the humanities, and therefore with the first nucleus of Scripps College. Amy's dedication to the Scripps faculty, its individual members, but also its overall coherence as an academic body, is, in my experience here, unequaled. It is under her steering and encouragement that the conditions of faculty of life have improved so greatly and promise to keep doing so. Her energy is otherworldly, and her alarm clock seems to be set to a very early hour. Anyone who has worked closely with her will be familiar with her habits of communication. Even when we wake up at what we think is a respectable hour, squinting at our phones to reckon with the tasks facing us that morning, we discover that Amy has already had a full day of work. Our morning inbox consists of spam, friends in New York, and Amy. The timestamps are themselves things of wonder. 6:54 a.m., 5:24 a.m., and the record holder in my own email archive, a message to report a successful faculty recruitment sent at 4:09 a.m., which means that for most of my career so far at Scripps, my days have often begun with words from Amy. Fortunately, those words bring welcome news far more often than bad. She has resolved some kind of impasse. She has tracked down the obscure but necessary section from the faculty handbook. She has secured extra funding for your research project. She has confirmed the accuracy of something you have said in a committee meeting. These communications are marked above all by their generosity, probably Amy's most characteristic quality. So, President Marcus-Newhall, though I can't welcome you to Scripps, I can certainly congratulate you on this appointment, thank you for everything thus far, and wish you my very best for the years to come. It's now my honor to welcome Lily Duncan, class of 2024, and president of Scripps Associated Students.
Today, I have the distinct honor and privilege of speaking on behalf of the student body and Scripps student government and extending our warmest congratulations and welcome to Amy Marcus-Newhall in her newest tenure as president. We're excited and optimistic about the future of her leadership. And I personally had the opportunity to speak at the last NSPO event as well, and my family was in the audience. This isn't part of my speech, but I just wanted to say that my parents were so touched that you came and shook their hands. That really, really meant a lot to my family, and to see your family here today is really just so telling of your character as an educator. Scripps College is an exceptional place of learning, growth, and empowerment. It's a place where students come to gain knowledge and experience, but it's also a place where I have watched my friends' voices flourish and their place in the community thrive. It is a place that celebrates their unique strengths. College is a critical time, and Scripps College is a particularly powerful place. At the heart of this transformative journey is the relationship between students and the institution itself. And to be honest, that's not much of a deep statement so much as it is an explanation of how schools work. There are students and there are people who keep the school functioning. And the resulting byproduct is what we students call the student experience. And what you hope for as a student is that you gain something from this experience that isn't just debt, but that you become a better person and a leader and a communicator, and you hope that you meet your lifelong friends or you try a new sport or a new hobby, and you hope, as I hope for the people sitting behind me, that I look back on my college days fondly. And that's really hard. It's definitely not an easy ask from an institution, and it takes a lot of support and a lot of nurturing. And in order to have this kind of idyllic student experience, you need people who are consistently there and unselfishly provide a place for you to grow. And I think that consistency is the operative word there in President Marcus-Newhall's case. Unlike you, President Marcus-Newhall, I am not a scientist, but like a good liberal arts student, I will apply what little I do know about the scientific method to this observation. In the collegiate experience, the independent variable is ourselves as college students. We're constantly changing, and college is hard, and it's also a huge change. Being this age is hard, while trying to figure out what I want to do and who I want to hang out with and how I fit into it all while still getting A's and going to office hours, it's really challenging. The dependent variable is the student experience, which relies on us challenging ourselves in this way. And that experience can be based on how we choose to apply ourselves. But in order for this to be a fruitful experiment, there needs to be control variables. Consistency that we can rely on while everything else is changing and being questioned around us. I remember in my freshman year of 2020, sitting in my family's basement on Zoom with my camera off, watching the then Vice President of Academic Affairs fielding question after question from what I think was your garage, maybe, about how we were gonna get students out of breakout rooms and back into Scripps classrooms. And then I remember again when that same Vice President stepped up to the plate as interim president my sophomore year, and then again my junior year. President Marcus-Newhall, the role you play in our student experience has been absolutely critical. You're not just the face of the institution, you have been an essential control variable in my life here at Scripps College. I am so grateful for the consistent support you have provided the students at Scripps College for the past 30 years. Your reliability and leadership have not gone unnoticed by students. We welcome you as you are finally recognized for stepping into the role that you have stepped into time and time again. And as you bring us into our centennial as a university, may your tenure mark a new era of Scripps College. We're in a genuine culture of listening, empowering, and collaborating with students permeates at every level. I would now like to introduce the lovely Marcy Robinson, who is the representative of staff council and the director of events here at Scripps College.
Well, hello, everyone. On behalf of staff council, I'm honored to be able to share a few words about our fearless president, Amy Marcus-Newhall. Let me start off with a recent event that took place last March, our spring 2023 staff breakfast. Well, there we received our yearly college updates and highlights from the semester, including news of reunion and commencement. But there was a bit of kinetic energy in the room as the announcement of our new president had just been shared a few days earlier. And then just as the program was about to end, Amy was introduced and asked to come up to the podium. Well, the roaring applause was deafening, and screams of joy crescendoed into a rousing standing ovation. And in that very moment, it showed me and all of us how much Amy is loved and appreciated for not only her work as the dean of the college for so many years and two stints as our interim president, but it is her commitment, dedication, care, love for our community, and willingness to step up yet again to move the college forward. As staff members of this community, we were thrilled and proud that Amy was once again given the opportunity to steer the ship and lead us and the college to new heights. You could feel the energy in that room that day, and in some way, we were awed by the decision of the board to right the ship with Amy at the helm. It was truly a blessing. Amy has gotten to know so many of us. Why? Because she chooses to. Because she wants to. She engages, she supports, and she listens. She's curious to hear about our latest projects, our plans that are underway for, say, family weekend, admitted student day, or NSPO. She's recently shared that she and her daughter, Rachel, will be attending several of our Scripps Presents program this fall. Super excited about. When you're in her company, you hear her passion for Scripps and our students and our amazing faculty and our staff. Amy has been a proponent and a huge supporter of staff council, and I'm proud to be a member of it. It's an entity on campus that creates programs to strengthen the bonds of our staff and find ways to bring folks together. Amy supports our charitable events that we launch each year with the greater community, such as Shoes That Fit, Toys for Tots, and our annual staff coffees and mixers. She loves to engage, share proud moments with us, and always finds ways to show her appreciation and value for all of us and the work that we do, whether it's through a collective email or a personal one. In addition to her keen ability to lead, Amy loves to give back. I personally have had the opportunity to see this in action as part of the advisory board with Camp Kesem, an organization led by students across the consortium supporting children in the greater community whose parents are cancer survivors or struggling with the disease. I see Amy in action as a fellow advisor, and I see how she mentors these students without imposing her will or pushing any agenda. She's a role model and has supported the mission of Kesem since the Claremont chapter was first launched in 2015 by students of the five C's. Amy provides resources, guidance, and support for students, student leaders each year, and promotes the mission of Kesem widely across the consortium, the greater community, and with her family and friends. So in a nutshell, I speak on behalf of the staff when I say we are grateful for your leadership, Amy, and we love you. Thank you. At this time, please join me in welcoming Emily Rankin, trustee and president of the Scripps College Alumni Association.
I hope everyone's bearing the heat just a little bit today. I'm Emily Rankin, Scripps class of 1997 and president of the Alumni Association. In considering the warmest welcome that the Alumni Association could offer President Marcus-Newhall on the occasion of her inauguration, I found myself looking for inspiration from other alums and online forums, from classmates, from Scripps's history of powerful women leaders, many of whom are with us here today. And through my research and conversations, Amy, I have come to believe that you are the real-life Las Amuse. Over these decades, you have been the sower of the good seeds of thought, of action, and of life. Amy joined the Scripps College community in 1992, 1 year before I stepped onto this campus as a first-year student. My class has certainly paralleled Amy's life and career here at Scripps. Many shared with me their favorite classes that they took with Amy, where they learned strategies and lessons that still resonate with them today. They shared with me their tremendous experience about her being their thesis advisor, the laughter, the tears, the personal discoveries, and the friendships and kinships found. Others shared with me more recent experiences with Amy and how they felt a connection to this space and this place because of how Amy has always personified all that is Scripps College. One alumna said, "Amy has always felt like the presence of confidence, courage, and hope through the simple act of being a professor and campus leader that respected her students and knew that we could rise to the occasion." Amy has always been willing to participate in the life of the college. When I was serving as the director of alumni relations, Amy happily accepted requests to be featured faculty speakers at alumni events, on the road, or during reunion weekend. She would take the time to speak with those in attendance, from alums to parents to friends, and she would bring them into the fold by offering them a window into the educational experience that represented that of current students. It has been said before and will be said again, Amy embodies all that is Scripps College. Her unwavering optimistic outlook on life, her desire to include every member of this community in the shared celebrations, successes of the students and the faculty, and the sometimes difficult decisions we must make as a community. All of these things have defined her tenure and her leadership here. As alums, this place and this community is home. Every time I step on this campus, I feel a sense of pride and a sense of belonging. This is the place where I found my voice and learned how to be a leader, forged lifelong friendships with alums from across the decades that continue to fill my life with joy. The memories and connection you can feel to a place are only as powerful as the people in it. President Marcus-Newhall, you have always led by example. You have always stepped up to lead when asked, and you have always done so with grace, power, and vision. The very quintessence of Las Amuse. The alumni are so very proud of you. It's with great enthusiasm, heart, and hope for the future that on behalf of the Alumni Association, I welcome you as the 11th president of Scripps College. It is now my pleasure to introduce another alumna, Ashley Polly.
Okay, here we go. So it is an immense honor to stand before you all today. We're going to go back in time. So in November of 2003, I was a 17-year-old girl trying to figure out where to go to college, and I decided to visit a women's college called Scripps for a two-day fly-in program. I was unbelievably nervous as a first-gen kid with immigrant parents who told me on the day that we drove up that no matter where I went to college, I was going to live at home until I was 35, possibly 40. The visit was going really well, met lots of nice people, and then I sat in on a class. It was a social psychology course in Steele Hall, taught by Professor Amy Marcus-Newhall. It is no exaggeration to say that 20 years later, I remember everything about that class. Three things stood out in my mind. One, everyone called her Amy. Two, she was fun, smart, confident, and comfortable leading the class through the lesson that was super interesting. And three, a young man in the front row raised his hand to say that he was confused about something. So Amy stopped the class and spent 5 minutes going deeper into the subject, saying at the end that if he didn't understand, that meant others might not either. In my hyper-competitive high school, none of those three things would have ever happened. So obviously, from that moment on, I became Amy's biggest super fan. See, I wasn't just a fan, I silently lurked. I was admitted to Scripps, and when anyone asked why a women's college, I would say, Dr. Amy Marcus-Newhall, let's Google her. And it was true, I'd like make people actually start researching her. When I got to Scripps, I chose not to ever speak to Amy, but simply went everywhere that she did. Swifties have nothing on me. By the end of my first year, I was standing in the back of the Humanities Auditorium after an Amy presentation, and the president of what was at the time called Wanawake Weyusi found me hovering in the back of the room and exclaimed, really rather loudly, I might add, you still haven't spoken to her? And she forced me to go up and introduce myself. From then on, I became president, vice president, treasurer, and secretary of the I Stan Amy Marcus-Newhall Club. I took all of her classes, all of her classes. I built my entire schedule around it. She became my advisor, and I asked her advice on every single decision I made in my life. I am not kidding. As my husband reminded me this morning, when we first started dating, I informed him that we couldn't get married if Amy did not approve of him. I actually have a picture of my mom with Amy sitting behind her on my wedding day. So why am I such a big Amy fan? Amy is a teacher. She cared so, so deeply about all of us students and always wanted to make sure that we were challenged, that we were growing, and that we knew how to think for ourselves. She pushed us hard. Sometimes too hard, Amy, but that's okay. But it made us better communicators and problem solvers. Amy also embodied so deeply the values of a women's college. She believed in us, often more than we believed in ourselves. I knew that she truly believed I could reach the highest of highs, even when I was feeling the lowest of lows. Amy is also so deeply committed to diversity and equity. It just flows out of her. She taught me to articulate injustices happening in the world, but also forced me to see solutions in the darkness. Even last night, she congratulated me on some new initiative I'd been able to achieve at work, and then immediately asked what support systems and equitable solutions will we have in place for the students who will be impacted by the new initiative. And I said, it's so good to see you too, Amy. As Amy taught me and has continued to push me for 20 years, don't put lip service to liberty. Action and authenticity are vital. And lastly, Amy never forgets people. She celebrates every win and will pick you up when you fail. In all this time, Amy has never forgotten to wish me a happy birthday, often at 4 a.m. Amy, it will always be one of the greatest honors of my life that you asked me to speak today about the exceptional president that I know that you will be. As I've felt every day for the last 20 years, you are everything I want to be when I grow up. Congratulations. And, oh, hello. And now, it is my great pleasure to welcome the homegirl, Dr. Melissa Macinist, class of 2012, to the stage.
Next after her. I'm excited to be a part of this special moment for President Marcus-Newhall. I first met Amy during my second day at Scripps College. I was a scared 18-year-old who was quite overwhelmed by her busy orientation schedule and unsure how to address her advisor. When I got to Amy's office, she greeted me with a big smile and energetic hello. Amy provided me comfort during our chat as she shared she was returning to Scripps from sabbatical, so she was a first year too. I felt so much relief in this moment because I knew I was not alone. This marked the beginning of a wonderful mentorship between Amy and me. As a Scripps student, Amy nurtured my confidence in her research lab and classroom and encouraged me to pursue my own research interests. As I grew as a student, I also had the privilege to witness Amy's leadership. When she became the dean of faculty, she asked me, "Do you want to stay my student?" I said, "Yes, yes, yes, it doesn't matter," and accepted the National Arts and Humanities Program Award on behalf of the Scripps College Academy, where she met First Lady Michelle Obama. Amy was a pivotal role model to me, and I was very happy to see her at my commencement right over there and share a hug and picture with her. After I graduated from Scripps, I stuck around for a few years as a staff member in admissions and student affairs, where I continued to build community with my Scripps family. In 2015, I was getting ready to leave for graduate school when it was announced that Amy would become interim president of the college. My mind was blown. I was like, my advisor, my professor, my mentor is going to be president? As a first-gen student and graduate, I think I was experiencing the awe of the fact that someone I knew so closely was going to be president. But after my amazement calmed, I immediately thought, well, of course, Amy would be perfect for this role. Although I was not at Scripps during Amy's tenure as interim president and the second one, each year I received birthday wishes from her as well, and I was able to learn a little bit about her presidency. Now we fast forward to 2020 when I was figuring out my next steps after graduate school amidst the pandemic. A full circle moment happened when I received an offer from Scripps to be a Consortium for Faculty Diversity Fellow in the Psychology Department. This was truly a full circle moment because Amy offered me this position as Dean of Faculty. I never thought that I would be colleagues with my mentor, so when I arrived at Scripps as a faculty member, I was truly touched to be welcomed by Amy and have the opportunity to continue to learn from her. I share these moments with you because they exemplify Amy's leadership, commitment, sacrifice, and love for our Scripps family. Amy, thank you for all that you've given to the Scripps community. I am so excited to witness your tenure as our 11th president. Thank you. Now it is my pleasure to introduce Amy's daughters, Rachel and Emily Newhall, which I've heard since 2008 and got to meet today.
As said, my name is Emily, and this is my sister, Rachel, and we are the very proud daughters of the new Scripps president and our most favorite mom. We are, thank you. We are here today on behalf of the entire Marcus-Newhall family, including many who are in the audience, as well as those who could not physically be here but are definitely in our hearts, especially our grandmother, Grammy, a lifelong public school teacher who would have been the most proud of all today. With so much pride and joy in my heart, I am so grateful to watch the extraordinary woman that is my mom step into this position. Since I can remember, my mom has expressed her unwavering passion for education and her deep love for Scripps. Her time at Scripps has been more than just a job to her, but her life's work, her passion. After getting in big trouble for spark-noting my homework and being lectured about current events in social psychology time and time again, it's fair to say that my mom is intensely passionate about not only school, but true and authentic learning. She both preaches the values of Scripps and embodies them. I am so excited to watch my mom inspire transformation, create community, and bring love to Scripps just as she has for me and my family. As she has stayed up all night to sing us Fiddler on the Roof when we couldn't fall asleep and given us hugs when we most need one, she embodies selflessness and care. And seeing as Scripps is like another one of her children, you are in good hands. So to Scripps College, you have not only gained an exceptional leader and powerful advocate, but a loving soul and a true light in this life.
So our mom has worked at Scripps for our entire lives. Whenever we had a fever or a cold growing up, and couldn't go to school, you could find us here on the floor in the back of a Scripps classroom while she was teaching Why Good People Do Bad Things or Communities of Hate. The curriculum may have been a little bit different than what the other third graders were learning that day, but it was moments like these, watching our mom work at Scripps, that taught me and my siblings what unwavering commitment looks like. She showed us that commitment is not just a word, it's a decision we get to make every day. And that when we do commit to something greater than ourselves, we have the ability to create positive change and find joy, meaning, and friendship along the way, just like she has. Today we wanted to share a poem that we think encapsulates our mom's commitment to Scripps. Pedro Arrupe writes, "Nothing is more practical than falling in love. What you are in love with, what seizes your imagination, will affect everything. It will decide what will get you out of bed in the morning, what you do with your evenings, how you spend your weekends, what you read, whom you know, what breaks your heart, and what amazes you with joy and gratitude. Fall in love, stay in love, and it will decide everything." Our mom fell in love with Scripps over 31 years ago, and it is that love that has driven her work every day since. On behalf of our entire family, we want to express just how proud we are of our mom and how grateful we are that our family gets to be part of the Scripps family. Thank you.
Thank you so much. If I could please have the former board chairs, Roxanne Wilson, Mark Herron, Lynn Thompson. This assembly serves to commemorate the past and present, and more importantly, to celebrate the boundless future ahead. Scripps stands resolute in its current position, fortified by its achievements, and resolution in its aspirations to further build upon its legacy and continue its significant role in women's education. Sustaining this ongoing success requires astute, genuine, and resolute leadership. Leadership that shall build upon the visionary achievements of our esteemed founder, Ellen Browning Scripps. The Board of Trustees, after careful consideration, has chosen Amy Marcus-Newhall to carry on this important work at Scripps College because we know her ability to lead is matched only by her ambition for this institution's continued success. If we could have Amy come to the podium. At this time, Roxanne Wilson, Mark Herron, Lynn Thompson, Jean Bixby-Smith, myself speak for the Board of Trustees. We exercise our privilege and responsibility in installing Amy Marcus-Newhall as the William M. Keck Presidential Chair and 11th President of Scripps College.
Hi, and welcome. I am deeply honored to be standing before you, over 400 or 500 of you connected directly or indirectly with Scripps on this very special occasion. I'd like to start by thanking those here today and those who make Scripps such a tremendous institution. To you, Laura, as our current board chair, and to the Board of Trustees, past and present, thank you for your unparalleled dedication to Scripps and putting your faith in me, and my hat is falling off, and so I'm just taking it off. There we go. Yes. You know what? I can easily adjust to all kinds of things. And for putting your faith in me to lead our college into its centennial. To the Inauguration Planning Committee and to those who spoke so eloquently today, thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you for creating the celebration of Scripps that embodies our tradition of education and community. To our staff, thank you for giving 100% of yourself day in and day out for this institution. A special thank you to those who contributed to this event today. A round of applause for everybody who's been involved in everything necessary for this. to our faculty. There's a lot of them actually here today, more than usually come to commencement. I am honored and thrilled. Thank you for your leadership in educating the next generation and driving forward your scholarship. I am proud to call you my colleagues, my partners, and my friends. To our students, thank you for giving up a Friday night to celebrate here tonight. I look forward to engaging and working with you. And to the alums, families, public officials, delegates, and friends who have traveled from near and far to support Scripps College, me, and the advancement of higher learning, thank you. You are the wind beneath our wings, and you truly warm my heart. Lastly, thank you to my family. My husband moved, so I won't see him and cry. You are my strongest advocates, my greatest inspiration, and my most wonderful role models. I love you all. Today, as I stand here before you as the 11th president to serve Scripps College, I think about when I first arrived here 31 years ago as a faculty member in the psychology department. I was thrilled to be at a liberal arts college and even more excited by the notion of being part of a women's college that was founded by Ellen Browning Scripps, who was committed to innovation, breadth, justice, and freedom. Molly McLean, in her Ellen Browning Scripps biography, reported that EBS's greatest ambition was for the college to be ready to try out new experiments, to be innovators in the work of entering new fields, and to prioritize academic freedom. She stated that, quote, "There shall be no clamp put on the search for truth in whatever direction it may be found." Ellen Browning Scripps was a visionary. She dedicated herself to addressing social inequities, and each of us as members of the Scripps community has the privilege of continuing her mission forward. The best way to do so is by looking at the promise that Scripps makes to its community, the promise that I make of how I will lead as president, and the promise that we will all work toward for the future. What is Scripps' promise to the community? Scripps makes the promise of self-determination for its students. Ellen Browning Scripps' vision was for the ability of women to shape a life for themselves independent of social expectations and norms, and separate from roles defined by marital or familial relationships. And the beauty of this visioning is that it is within a coeducational environment that replicates the world beyond the college borders. This self-determination allows for, rather initiates, curiosity, creativity, independence, and self-confidence. Scripps also makes the promise of belonging and support. Scripps is a place that fosters intellectual, emotional, and physical growth and well-being, both individually and collectively. When we think of community at Scripps, there is a focus on students, as there well should be. But there is also a focus on staff and on faculty. We know that we are all better when we look out for one another, when we care about one another, and when we respect one another. And Scripps makes the promise of access. Education is a lever for expanding opportunity and making the world more equitable and humane. Access attempts to level the playing field for those whose options are more limited by background or social norms. Access provides an environment that fosters collaboration and brings unique and differing perspectives for the betterment of all. We are here because we were drawn by the promise Scripps College made to us. We stay connected because we continue to see that promise fulfilled in the lives of our classmates, colleagues, and community members, and because that promise inspires hope, loyalty, and affection for this remarkable institution. What is my promise of how I will lead as the Scripps president? I will stay as committed and compassionate and caring about Scripps as I have for the past 31 years. Scripps is my home away from home. I am dedicated to the important work that needs to be done and will work tirelessly on its behalf. I will do so with a collaborative leadership approach by building, sustaining, and nurturing relationships. I am fortunate to know so many of you. What a benefit it is to come from within the college and have these established relationships. And how excited I am to meet those of you who I do not yet already know. The Scripps community is strong and consists of those here at Scripps, students, staff, and faculty, and those outside of our walls, alums, family, and friends. Scripps reflects the people who comprise our community. We share in our passion for Scripps, and I am eager to engage with you on behalf of Scripps. I also will act with integrity in the best interest of Scripps. I will gather input from appropriate constituencies. I will demonstrate the value of shared governance. I am committed to doing what is right, even when it is hard or unpopular. I will act on behalf of what is good for Scripps, not just for today and not just for specific constituent groups, but rather for the college's well-being today and in the future. What is the promise of Scripps moving forward? The promise of Scripps moving forward is that any student who is admitted to Scripps can attend regardless of financial status. Yes, good clapping. Our priority is to open our doors even wider for students of all backgrounds who have the capacity to thrive at Scripps. Our mission, quote, to educate women to develop their intellects and talents through active participation in a community of scholars so that as graduates they may contribute to society through public and private lives of leadership, service, integrity, and creativity, end quote, is so important that it needs to be available to all qualified applicants to Scripps College. The promise of Scripps in the future is that our unique perspective, our academic experience, our holistic approach, and our contribution to the higher education landscape is valued, appreciated, and recognized, and that we serve as a leader among women's and liberal arts colleges locally, nationally, and internationally. The promise of Scripps in the future is that our graduates depart Scripps even more equipped to achieve their loftiest educational and professional ambitions, influencing communities, organizations, governments, and industries. Our students are too impressive and their education too meaningful not to have this be so. And the promise of Scripps in the future is to begin our second 100 years in 2026 by transforming lives, building community, and cultivating brilliant, fierce, compassionate leaders who think clearly and independently and lead lives of confidence, courage, and hope. I know that many of you are here because you agree that this is a future worth believing in, investing in, pursuing, and sharing with the world. I am honored to be in service to this wonderful college and its mission. I look forward to working in community with you in interesting, productive, and creative ways to fulfill the Scripps promise. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amy. And in the spirit of giving gifts, you have each received a tin of Scripps tea to commemorate today's inauguration as a small token of Scripps College to take home with you. And finally, before I do close the program, I want to acknowledge that the events of this weekend have required the organization and effort of a small army of volunteers and staff. I really would like to thank the Inauguration Committee and its many subcommittees and its co-chairs, Trustee Kalpana Rhodes, and Vice President and Board Secretary Denise Nelson Nash for an unforgettable day of events. Join me in thanking Kalpana, Denise, and the exceptional team for a job well done. And now will you please stand and remain at your seats until the recessional has concluded. Denise Nelson Nash will come to the podium after the recessional to greet you. Thank you all so much for coming.
I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend, 'cause I've heard